Good morning and welcome once again to another week as we continue to share these moments together, to enjoy the beautiful presence of God in our midst. And today is the feast of Saint Peter and Saint Paul, and we give thanks to God for these two great men of faith who would have shaped in many ways the faith that we now share. And we pray God that he may continue to inspire many through their lives and their service. And let's begin our devotions now as we join in music. All the earth bows down before you. Blessed are God, you peoples. Gracious and loving God, we salute you this day in thanksgiving for the rest of the past night. We ask that during this day, we would be mindful of your continued presence and love. and things we do not understand, help us to be patient and wait on your guidance. Help us to trust that the journey on which you have placed us is indeed not only for our benefit, but that of those around us. May we greet each opportunity with the knowing that you are in everything and everything is in you. We ask this through Jesus, whom we call the Christ. Amen. Almighty God, whose blessed apostles Peter and Paul glorified you by their martyrdom, grant that your church, instructed by their teaching and example, and knit together in unity by your Spirit, may ever stand firm upon the one foundation, which is Jesus, the Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our reading today is taken from the Gospel according to St. John, the 21st chapter, beginning to read at the 15th verse. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wish. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not want to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." Here ends the reading. After this, he said to him, "Follow me. Follow me." These are the words of Jesus to Peter in this time, where Jesus is seeking to allow Peter to understand what it is that he is calling on him to do. What is the purpose of all that he is going through? Jesus is seeking to help Peter in this time to come to a place where he knows and understands what all of this is about. This is perhaps one of my most favorite passages, because it is one of those dialogues that you have to sit and really listen to and allow it to sink in and ask yourself, what is really going on here in this dialogue? What is Jesus doing? What is Jesus attempting to do with poor Peter? Backdrop, the night in the Garden of Gethsemane, the arrest, Peter drawing close, trying to find out what has happened to Jesus, but not getting too close lest he be recognized as part of Jesus's team. Peter being recognized as he stayed close to a fire and being identified as one of them, and Peter swearing that he doesn't even have a clue what people are talking about. And this is now post-resurrection. Jesus has come, he has shown himself to the disciples, he has engaged them. No doubt they would have all have felt away in those first days of being with Jesus after his crucifixion and resurrection. But this is the farewell scene, as it were, for Jesus and his buddy Peter. And in this farewell scene, we see Jesus coming to Peter and saying to Peter something that is really hurtful in a sense, but yet redeeming and strengthening at the same time. Remember, Peter is the rock, and I spoke to you about this some weeks back. Peter is the rock on which the church will be built. And Jesus needs to be sure that Peter understands what the nature of that rock is. The nature of that rock must be unconditional love. It must be love beyond the superficial. It must be love beyond the physical. It must be a deep and abiding love that nothing is able to separate. It must be the love of God. And so by taking Peter through these three questions, Jesus is seeking to have Peter go deeper and deeper and deeper until he gets to that place of total abandonment. And you hear it. You hear it in Peter's voice. As John records the words, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." You could hear the resolve. You could hear that sense of, I don't know what else to say. There's nothing else there. There's nothing that any longer stands between us. I love you. And Jesus needs that kind of love from Peter. Our world is so caught up with our physicality that we don't really understand that that's the love that we are called on to demonstrate to each other. We see glimpses of it in David and Jonathan, back in the Old Testament. We understand it to some extent in the life of Jesus and Mary Magdalene. And this is seen more so in the Gospel of Mary than in the canonical Gospels. Also the Gospel of Thomas. But in this canonical Gospel, we are seeing it with Peter and Jesus. But at the same time, we also saw it in virtually every one of Jesus's miracles, healing miracles, and to some extent his parables. That constant motivation or action out of a place of unconditional love. That is what the human family is working towards. The return home. The return to the place of love. But there is that understanding that we can't really know love unless we leave it. And that is shown us in the parable of the prodigal son. One fellow stays home and one leaves. The one that leaves feels the separation. He feels the pain of not being with his father, not being in his home. He finds himself in dire circumstances. And these dire circumstances are just symbolic of not being at home, of not being in that loving environment. And he decides he's going to go back home. He's had enough of this experience. He goes back home and he feels the love. He experiences the love. The other son who stayed at home has no understanding of that love. He challenges his father, and the father says, "But I love you. Everything I have is yours." But the thing here is that that son never left it. So because he never left it, he doesn't have an appreciation of the depth of it. And that's what our journey is. We have left the Father. We have left the divine's presence. We've come out into a world. And like the prodigal son, we are experiencing the absence of that divine love, that grace, that joy, that peace. But we're doing that in order that we can understand what it is, so that we can even begin to reclaim it from here. Other son who stayed at home has no understanding of that. It is like the fish in the ocean not having a sense of what water is. He is just completely surrounded at all times by it. Jesus wanted to know that if nothing else, that Peter got the message that he brought. He needed to know that Peter understood that the way home was through love. Unconditional love. No matter who it is. No matter what condition they're in. It is love. Love is the only healing tool. And if we could, in this world, really go after that gift of unconditional love, we would be greater healers. We would see the miracles before us. We would see the wonder and the power of God in our world. If we can only realize that the only thing that matters is love, true love, deep love. It is love that causes us to be there in the world for others. It is love that causes us to join with others to assist them. It is love that caused Jesus to come into the world with a plan to suffer. Not empty suffering, not just wasted suffering, but knowing that through his act of suffering, a significant new dimension of love will emerge. Somehow, somewhere along the line, I think we have misunderstood this. And perhaps we need to be addressed as Peter was and ask that question on three occasions to see if what we are doing causes us to understand that we are instruments of love. We are not here to control or to dictate, but alas, our various institutions have sought to do that through the millennia, and in some ways have held back the human family from being that body of love. But a new day is dawning, and perhaps the youth in our midst have decided not to follow our paths, but they are creating anew. They are going for the original. They're getting in touch with Source. And they are renewing themselves as instruments of grace. And this time, those of us who have come through the old system, who honestly know that there are so many places that the system has failed us. There's so much that's been lacking, but it is all that we have known. We who are the products of that journey must stop and be as Peter this morning, and allow ourselves to be recalibrated with the divine love of God, knowing that it is about love. It is not about numbers. It is not about our doctrine. It is not about our church. It's not about our pastor. It's not about our system of belief. It's about none of that. All of these are man-made, and there's nothing really wrong about man-made systems as long as they serve the true purpose, which is to bring persons into the true realization of themselves as instruments of God's grace. Not when those systems become self-serving. And those systems become self-serving, they need to be challenged. Today, as we listen on the news and we see that there is a new pandemic, as it were, Black Lives Matter, in the midst of another pandemic that is so dangerous, yet persons are risking their lives because for them there is a greater pandemic, and they're challenging the systems that have been silent, the systems that have pretended that all is well, the systems that are not built on love, the systems that are being supported by even the church. The place that Jesus placed for the demonstration of love, that place being an active participant in things that are horrifying to the human family. The persons that are asking for more than an apology from the church, but they're asking persons like myself. We are all in this together. And it's not about an apology or reparations at this time. What is it about? It's about coming once more to truth. If that which we have inherited is erroneous, if it has flaws, if we see the flaws, we don't have to condemn. All we have to do is find the truth and reinstall the truth. When my computer develops a virus or a file that is corrupted and it is no longer functioning as it should, I either take it to the shop or I do it myself. I reset it to the factory settings. I wipe the drive and I restore the settings or the programs that it came with. And it takes a long time because it has to then upgrade and update all of these things since time has passed. But at the end of the day, I know that what I have now is where the original would have taken me. My friends, this is our work. This is our work. It's not a time for finger pointing. It is a time where we need to go back to the origin, as Jesus took Peter back, as Jesus rebooted Peter. Peter, do you love me more than these? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? This is what this is about. And this is where we need to be in our journey with God. We need to come back to the beginning and once again put ourselves in the places where God would have us be, in order that we may come forward. And in coming forward, we may know what our purpose is, and we may take this world in the direction it needs to go. I pray, God, that we will all have the courage as we hear the Master challenge us, as he challenged Peter, to come back to the core and begin again.